Good day. My name is Pastor Lori Mickelson from the Church of the Nazarene here in Chetwynd. Welcome to our Sunday service, and thank you to CHET TV for your help in getting God's Word out. I think I can safely say that as we come to the close of another year, there is much anxiety in the air. The churches are still shut down to public worship, and the numbers of those getting sick just seem to be so unstable. So what are we to do with anxiety and fear? Let's open with prayer. O Lord, we thank you that you are an ever-present help in time of trouble. We thank you that you bring hope where there seems to be no hope. And we thank you that you bring peace into the midst of chaos. We ask that you bring our community peace and compassion, even in the midst of all that is going on around us. We know that you are in the boat with us. We need not fear. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to turn to a well-known story in Matthew chapter 8, 23 to 27. Then Jesus got into the boat and started across the lake with his disciples. Suddenly a fierce storm struck the lake, with waves breaking into the boat. But Jesus was sleeping. The disciples went, woke him up, shouting, "Lord, save us, we're going to drown." Jesus responded, "Why are you afraid? You have so little faith." Then he got up and rebuked the wind and the waves, and suddenly there was great calm. The disciples were amazed. "Who is this man?" they asked. "Even the winds and the waves obey him." Can you blame the disciples for being afraid? Andrew, Peter, James, and John were fishermen. That is how they made their living. Thomas, Nathanael, and Philip may have also worked as fishermen, for they were all together and fishing when Jesus appeared to them in John 21, verses 2 to 8, following his resurrection. They were used to boats. They were used to the Sea of Galilee. They were also used to the violent storms that could come up on that body of water due to the surrounding terrain. I've read that even on that small lake, the waves could get as high as 6 feet. Most likely they had friends and probably family who had drowned. There are no safety regulations in those days, no life jackets, no emergency radios to call the Coast Guard. They did not have a powerful boat that could enable them to face into the waves. Andrew, Peter, James, and John were very aware of the danger of the situation. But what about Matthew, the tax collector? What about Simon the Zealot, a political troublemaker? What about Judas, a treasurer of the group? How would you have reacted if you were in that boat? How would I? What about Jesus? He's sleeping. We don't know how long the disciples waited before waking Jesus up, but by the time they did, they were desperate. "Lord, save us, we're going to drown," Matthew 8, 25. "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" Mark 4, 38. "Master, Master, we're going to drown," Luke 8, 24. Well, the fact is that Jesus did care. What did he do? First, Jesus addresses the disciples saying, "You of little faith, why are you so afraid?" Why did he take the time to ask that instead of just calming the sea? Let's take a look back and see what he was doing before this. Way back at the end of Matthew 4, we see Jesus calling his disciples. Matthew 4, 23 to 25. Jesus traveled throughout the region of Galilee, teaching in the synagogues and announcing the good news about the kingdom. He healed every kind of disease and illness. News about him spread as far as Syria, and people soon began bringing to him all who were sick, and whatever their sickness or disease, or if they were demon-possessed or epileptic or paralyzed, he healed them all. Large crowds followed him wherever he went, people from Galilee, the 10 towns, Jerusalem, from all over Judea, and from the east of the River Jordan. Did anything jump out at you from those verses? What about this phrase, "He healed them"? The disciples had seen Jesus healing every disease and sickness among the people. those suffering with pain, the demon-possessed, those with seizures, and the paralyzed. Huge crowds started to follow Jesus, and then he goes onto the mountainside to preach what is the most famous sermon ever, the Sermon on the Mount. When he comes down from that mountainside in chapter 8, he heals a man with leprosy. He heals the paralyzed, terribly suffering servant of a Gentile Roman centurion. Jesus didn't even have to go where the centurion's servant was. He just said the word and the servant was healed. Then he heals Peter's mother-in-law, and when evening came, many who were demon-possessed were brought to Jesus, and he brought out the spirits with a word and healed all the sick. Matthew 8, verse 16. Okay, so the disciples have been following Jesus and have seen all kinds of amazing miracles. But this storm is something else. This storm was not much like sicknesses. This storm was something bigger and much more immediate. And this was threatening their lives, and not just the lives of some person for whom they had little compassion. Let's look at what three different disciples yelled to Jesus above the noise of the wind and the waves that were crashing into the boat. Lord, save us, we're going to drown. Matthew 8, 25. Teacher, don't you care if we drown? Mark 4, verse 38. Master, master, we're going to drown. Luke 8, 24. And Jesus' response? You of little faith, why are you so afraid? They had all seen Jesus performing miracles of many kinds in the past few days. They had seen people filled with fear of sickness or diseases that they had, and they had seen Jesus heal them all. They had seen people filled with fear who were possessed by demonic spirits, and Jesus had delivered them. Did they think Jesus would not be able to save them from the storm? Was Jesus their last resort? Had they tried everything else before they came to him? But Jesus, in spite of their faith and their fear, simply got up and rebuked the winds and the waves, and it was completely calm. But this narrative isn't over yet. Just listen to how they reacted to this miracle, demonstrating Jesus' power over nature. Matthew 8, 27. The men were amazed and asked, what kind of a man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. Mark 4, 41. They were terrified and asked each other, who is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. Luke 8, 25. In fear and amazement, they asked one another, who is this? He commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him. Have you ever thrown a stone into a quiet pond? The ripples go out and they hit the shore and they come back, and it can take a while for the ripples to resolve into quietness. Here Jesus is speaking to the waves that could have been up to 6 feet high, and it was suddenly completely calm. So it is reasonable that the disciples were amazed, terrified, and filled with fear. Were they starting to get a glimpse of who Jesus really was? Do we actually have any notion of who Jesus really is? Okay, so let's reset to the beginning of this passage and try to apply it to our lives. Have you ever had a furious storm come up in your life? Something that was completely unexpected. Something that you were sure would sink you, either spiritually, emotionally, financially, or physically. Have you had something like that living nightmare? Something that you hoped would go away when you woke up. You have tried everything you can think of, and there is just no hope, no escape, and no salvation. Perhaps you're a mature Christian. Perhaps you've been following Jesus for many years and have been faithful to trust him and grow in your relationship with him. And the Holy Spirit has helped you to learn to go to Jesus at the first sign of trouble and even in times of peace. You see, Jesus was in the boat with the disciples all the time. They just weren't connected with him. I don't think that Jesus had told them, hey, I'm going to take a nap, so don't wake me up until we get to the other side. Jesus was there all the time, but they didn't engage with him. Perhaps you're a new Christian. Perhaps you've just placed your faith and trust in Jesus, and you don't know that you can go to him at any time, in any place. Perhaps you don't yet realize that Jesus is in the boat with you and in your time of trial. This is something we all need to learn. You see, the Bible says in Philippians 4, verses 6 to 7, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all that He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which will exceed anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Can you imagine if we would just live out that verse in our lives in a consistent manner? Those disciples who were fishermen must have known what was coming when the wind started whipping up the waves. What if they had gone to Jesus immediately with their petition? What if they had said, "Lord, there's a strong storm coming. We're so thankful that you're in the boat with us, and we trust you to see us through this storm." What if we were like that in our lives? "Lord, I don't know how to handle this situation. I feel like panicking, and I'm so glad that you're in this situation with me. I trust in you to see me through this for your honor and your glory." Can you imagine what a witness that would be to people in other boats? What a witness it would be to people going through their own trials? It could give strength to those who know Christ but are trying to solve the problem on their own. It could also be a witness to those who don't know Jesus as their Savior and only have themselves to depend upon. The possibilities are endless. Do you know any unsaved family members or friends who are going through various storms in their lives? Such difficulties in the life of an unbeliever may present an opportunity to introduce them to Jesus. I mean, think about it. Who came to Jesus? The sick, the lame, and the demon-possessed came to Jesus. The healthy may have been too busy, so they weren't there. We live in a sin-sick world. Many are drowning in the worries of life. Jesus said in John 10:10, "The thief's purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. My purpose is to give them a rich and satisfying life." Is the devil stealing, killing, and destroying your life? Is the devil stealing and killing and destroying the life of someone that you know and love? Turn to Jesus and find true life that is abundant and full. He is in the boat with you. You don't have to wake him up. He's very much awake and saying, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Matthew 11:28. So as we go through the days ahead, let's remind ourselves what we have learned from the Old Testament saints. Think about Moses and Pharaoh and the escape from Egypt. Think about Daniel in the lion's den. Think about Jonah in the belly of the whale. God's word is where we find peace. It is where we learn to trust God. His word has not changed. He is with us and will never leave us. So no matter what's happening around us, be not afraid. Have faith. Dear Lord, once again, you have reminded us that you are present and active in our lives. You have not changed. We see your presence all around us. Thank you for keeping us in these days, and we pray for those who don't know that peace that comes from knowing and trusting you. Bless our days, and may our constant prayer be our first resource rather than our last attempt. In Jesus' name, amen.